Yeah, really, just do. He took him.
1 minute, pick your nose in real quick.
What you gotta do?
Bob took it.
He should just come and meet you with Bob. He should just take her picture during the day. She's the only one.
Microphones are on.
A picture.
Before October 10th, I think that's when we're gonna.
My picture in the finance book is awful.
That's what I was checking right now. I'll take
yeah, you should do her
picture
like you did ours.
Oh, the portrait. For the finance book.
During the day, because you both can.
Happy to.
Mention it to the right person.
Well, I see it's 7 o'clock right on the nose. Good evening and welcome to the Middleton Cross Plains Area School District Board of Education meeting of September 12, 2022. We are now calling to order. We'll begin by introducing the board. First, the Superintendent Dana Minogue. Also with us tonight is Jared Rossing, Assistant Superintendent of Operations. Sylvia Romero Johnson, Assistant Superintendent of Teaching and Learning. Board members present are Annette Ashley, Bob Green, Sheila Hidner, Tabitha Hansen, Paul Kinney, Simranjeet Sirha, Gail Scheffler, and myself, Bob Hesselbein. We're going to start out with approval of minutes. We have two sets this evening for the board's approval, the August 22nd regular meeting minutes and the September 1st special meeting minutes. I'm looking for a motion for both.
Move to approve for both the regular minutes and special minutes.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. What a great start to the evening. Motion passes. We're going to start out with citizen comments. We have one written comment, but actually that individual is here tonight to speak with us, Rebecca Seaman. And Rebecca, allow me to read the boilerplate that we always do with public comments protocol. Okay, well, virtually, I have to work on, talk my last, state your name, your street address, and what school communities you may be affiliated with. If you represent a particular group, please state what that information is. Well, please limit your comments to 3 minutes or less. Please be advised, as you do know, the board cannot engage in dialogue with members of the community during the citizens' comment section. Welcome.
Okay. So my name is Rebecca Seaman, 2715 Birchwood Passing Cross Plains. I work at Sauk Trail and I am the MEA president. And now my time starts. So thank you for these few minutes to talk about the start of the 22-23 school year. Last week, MEA and the DSC administration had our first meeting confer of the school year, and I wanted to take a moment to share with you what we shared with them. There is a different type of feeling in the air this year, and it's feeling very positive. A lot of this has to do with the changes made with the kickoff of the school year, and a direct quote is, it was one of the most joyous starts of the year. Across the district, there were more opportunities on our PD and work days to prep spaces, meet with colleagues, and plan for students than previous years. The PD was relatable with the needs of the first weeks of school, and there was a constant theme of building relationships throughout the district. We reached out to MEA members to see what was going well and what we heard. And you'll see in your letter that it shows all the different ones, but I want to make sure that I get through everything. There were also many ways that staff supported students with their first days of school across the primary and secondary level. At Middleton High School, there was a Friday all-school resource that helped make students more comfortable in the building. A scavenger hunt helped students reconnect in advisory and also explore more of the building. It was fun and meaningful. At the middle school level, fifth graders came in on a day early to meet with teachers and eighth grade web, where everyone belongs, leaders, for a fun day of activities. There were lots of staff in the hallways eager to greet kids and answer questions. Supports for kids who needed it were available. These include fidgets, visuals, walks, headphones, etc. The first few days of school, the halls were filled with many staff members to support students as they entered the building and moved around during the day. Support staff connected early with new families and kids, and there were back to school nights. At the elementary level, there were many staff who supported students learning the new routines and expectations in the morning and throughout the day. Some of us even rode buses home to help everyone end up where they were supposed to be. There were also Ready, Set, Go conferences in some buildings and back to school nights in others to build community within the schools. At the Early Learning Center, students learned about their environment and built friendships inside the classroom and at recess through additional play opportunities. Additional notes heard were, ELC staff was thrilled to have the additional time to prepare their new amazing space. Elementary classroom teachers are thankful that breakfast is back in the cafeteria before the 7:40 bell, and that the soft start, which was having students in the classroom starting at 7:30, is no longer happening as it was last year. This provides them with those 10 valuable minutes back to finishing preparing for their students, and that they are grateful for. I assure you that a teacher can get a lot done in 10 minutes. Elementary staff appreciate having more preparation time in the first 3 days from previous years. Many voice feeling way more prepared for students than in years past. They hope this is a new yearly plan. Middleton school staff were given lots of time to meet as teams and in C3 teams to plan a strong start to the year. High school staff appreciated having extra time to prepare, even with changing one of the 3 days to provide a first day of school for freshmen to happen on the 31st. All staff appreciated having a wellness morning to remind them that taking time for themselves or to do something that brings them joy is essential for their mental and physical health. Hearing from the special education staff, a consistent message was being thankful that case managers will not be doing diagnostic assessments this year. Taking this off the table supported special ed staff to stay in the district when they could go to another district and make more money. And it was a selling point when new staff were offered multiple job offers. We saw multiple district leaders in the buildings taking the time to talk to staff and students, and we encouraged them to continue to stop by. We appreciate seeing them. We want to thank Dana for her back to school video. There was no extra message beyond, it's been hard, let's keep moving. And that's the right message and a great choice. We also want to thank Sherry for supporting MEA attending the new teacher induction days and continuing our yearly tradition. Finally, a thank you to Keith Schneider for his ability to find humor even when something is new and hard, and Mary Beth Polisi for collaborating with staff when they are tricky situations. And I'm sure there's a lot more, but I just wanted you to be aware that we're feeling really good this year. Okay.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Rebecca. Yay. Okay.
3 minutes. Okay, let's include citizen comments. Correspondence and board communications. We'll just work our way around the room. Sorry, Bob. Paul?
I went to back to school night at Cromrie Middle School, and it was wonderful. And I've been to lots of them over the years, and I just wanted to take a second to thank everybody behind the scenes to put it together, because it means a lot to the kids. It means even more to the parents, and I know that the people who do put it together already devote so much time and so much of their lives to everything. So it's a big thank you for taking that extra step yet again this year and helping to make a really great start to the school year.
I just wanted to thank everyone who came to the Good Neighbor Festival. I'm also part of that outside of the school board. And despite the rain, the Middleton Cross Plains Education Foundation was able to raise quite a significant amount of money. And that money will be used to support the arts in the district, so that's great. And I also wanted to thank, you know, the families and district staff for a great start to the school year. The high school is, again, a little bit different. So from my perspective, my sister said, still confusing, but they were able to, she said there's a lot of smiling people showing them where to go, and she said it was really great. So always good to hear that kids are happy to be in school.
Annette?
I wanted to echo something that was mentioned earlier at our finance committee meeting, and that is that we've seen our district staff go above and beyond and do things outside of what their normal job is, like Jared has been driving a Suburban to pick up kids, and we heard that Aaron Wheeler, our finance director, has been serving lunch at the Middleton High School, and Barb Buffington has also been jumping in a Suburban and taking a route in the morning, too. So I just wanted to say thank you. I know the other two, Aaron has left and Barb isn't here, but it's important to just say thank you, and I wanted to do that in a public space.
Thank you.
Well, I attended back to school night as PTO and not as a board, but it was great to see all of the families in the school, and they were just so excited to see other families and interact with other kids, and they were just so, so excited to be there. I've also been on a journey to meet with all of the heads of the district admin, and that has been very exciting because I'm trying to get to know what all the different jobs do. And so I think I've met with 21 heads so far. I think I have two left, so it's very exciting. And I'm learning a lot that I didn't know and what people do, so that's really, it's really good to know.
I think I'll just echo the comments that Paul made about back to school night. I had the pleasure of attending two of those at Glacier Creek and really appreciate everything that the admin and staff did to make that, as Paul said, it's a really valuable night for the families. And thanks as well to Dana and Sherry and to Percy and Keith for manning the referendum information table. I know a few folks stopped by. I hope it was many, but I appreciate the extra effort that you all went to staff that.
Yeah.
Part of the problem being one of the last people is everyone's covered everything I was going to talk about. I also went to the Cromrie back to school night. I, in addition to all the time there and all the effort the teachers were putting in, I appreciated having the school open beforehand. I have a fifth grader, so having some extra time to walk his schedule before back to school night so he could learn his way around the school was really appreciated without all of the hubbub of having families there. It was new to us because we were pandemic family last go around for a fifth grader, but it was nice that the district is thinking so carefully about the families and the time that they need to learn about a new school. The web experience as well, we had my son had his web day, which was great and had a nice time, and it's nice to have some eighth grade friends as a fifth grader. Had we done the high school tour at our last meeting? I can't remember.
Leap in and talk about it.
Okay. thanks to Dana for showing some of us around the new high school. We got an opportunity to get a sneak peek before school started of our crown jewel.
yes.
It's really beautiful and really big. That was exciting, and can't wait to hear some of the students' reactions to other than it being really huge. but I think having such a great learning space for students is really going to serve us well in the future. So that's all I have for tonight.
And even worse than the vice president, by the time it gets to me, everyone has talked about everything. But what I will encourage is to say that the remodeled and rebuilt high school is a dramatic step forward. October 6th, the public will have the opportunity at an open house to attend, and it's worth seeing what the investment of this community has resulted in as far as not just the structure, but the modern concepts and the designs and technology. Some you see when you're walking through, and others are in the ether, that's the electronic technology that's there. It's really something that we can all be proud in the district. Students, parents, and everyone in the community who helps contribute to that beautiful building and the technology and the people who work there. So that's, I'm going to start crying if I keep talking, so I better just move along in the conversation.
Hey, Bob, could I just jump in? Because I did forget about the tour. And I just wanted to comment, one of the things that really stood out to me was the maker spaces in terms of like the wood shop, the metal shop, some of the trade type things. In the past, the high school being, we were kind of cramped for space. Some of those spaces kind of got shortchanged, and now we have some really state-of-the-art things. So our students who are actually looking at something other than college have the ability to participate in the trades. We have a kitchens, we have the wood shop, we have the metal shop, we have different type of maker spaces. So we're not just college orientated anymore. Our kids now can take a look at a career that isn't just basically going to a four-year school. So again, very impressed. I think they did a fantastic job.
Very good. Now, the most exciting part of the night for me is always the legislative committee update.
Okay, happy to provide. So according to the Legislative Fiscal Bureau, the state tax collections continue to exceed projections by an estimated amount of $1.6 billion, which is extraordinary. So in reaction, the governor, Tony Evers, and State Superintendent Jill Underley have released kind of a plan of what they would like to do with this money. So this is not something that is in writing yet, but they're kind of thinking about it. And this plan that they've started to create includes improving reading and literacy outcomes, expanding access to student mental health services and school nutrition, providing financial literacy and out-of-school programming, addressing the staff shortages to help keep class sizes small, and to increase per pupil and special education aids while holding the line on property taxes. So they have a lot of ideas for this money, nothing passed into law yet, but kind of something that is separate yet still related. A separate set of money has been released by Governor Tony Evers. It's $90 million in federal funds, which will be given back to the school districts. This will allow for a $91.15 addition for per pupil aid. And we have to remember that this is one-time money, so this is not going to be reoccurring. So we'll have to be very careful in how we spend this as to be fiscally responsible. And then the remaining $15 million, so the per pupil aid will be going to all school districts, but then there's $15 million that will be left, which will go to the Get Kids Ahead initiative, which is for mental health in schools. So that is going to be happening for sure, the $90 million. Schools will be seeing that soon. And that's the update.
Thank you so much for that update. And now the superintendent's report.
All right. Good evening. The school year is off to a very strong start, and I will not say anything more about that because Rebecca did such a good job of explaining that. We are experiencing some challenges with busing and staffing shortages in our food service and paraprofessional areas. We, of course, apologize to our families for the inconvenience some of our transportation challenges have caused. However, good news, we do have several people who are sort of in the process of becoming drivers for us, and so we're hopeful that that is going to be helpful in the near future. Our recruitment efforts continue in all areas where we are still seeing vacant positions. One in particular, food service, and then also special education assistance. I am hearing out in our buildings that we have made some offers for some special education paraprofessionals, and so we're hopeful over the next week or so to welcome some more people into that employee group. Student and staff are reporting a really good start, thanks to the efforts of many. From our buildings and grounds crews, Jared and I were in two buildings today, and Jared said, I'm paraphrasing, but you said, I just can't get over what good shape our buildings are in. Our schools are in such good shape. Our custodial maintenance staff, our certified and non-certified staff, our food service folks, our front office staff, and our administrators. The startup period this year has not only felt good, it's felt much more typical. Which I think we're all just super excited about. Some calendar reminders and updates for the board. We have a virtual town hall on the referendum tomorrow at 6:30. People were asked to register beforehand, but I also did share with you the Zoom link for that meeting if you care to join us tomorrow. We have an in-person referendum town hall on Thursday of this week at Cromrie. Again, please let Cheryl know if you plan to attend. And then also there is a town hall at Park on September 20th at 6 o'clock. So some nice opportunities for us to share our referendum information with the larger community coming up here. Our annual meeting is scheduled for next Monday at 7 o'clock right here at DSC. And then we will be canceling our full board meeting on October 10th. We're still going to have agenda setting and finance that night, but we're going to be just having a full board meeting, one meeting in October, and that will be on the 24th. Lastly, Perry Hibner is not able to be with us tonight, so we will be pushing his referendum update from our agenda this evening to the September 27th Board of Education meeting. The board members have, and the community does too, has his presentation in our packet. He will be adding some more pertinent updates to that for the 27th. And that is my report tonight.
Wow, very good. Thank you so much.
Uh-huh.
Consent agenda.
Annette, did you have a question?
Yeah, what time is the Cromery, the presentation at Cromery? Is it 6 or 6:30?
I believe it's 7, but let me pull up my calendar. 7 o'clock.
Thank you.
Yes.
I was leaving ahead too quick. Are there any other questions, Superintendent? Okay, very good. Next agenda item will be consent agenda. I offer up for your approval of the following items: approval of bills payable, approval of employee services, and I am looking for a motion.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, a second. Hearing any discussion? Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Items for information discussion, as we talked about, the referendum update will be pushed back to a later board meeting. Now, next, we're going to have Director Percy Brown, who will provide a brief history on reviewing the Grow Your Own Agreement.
Good evening, everyone.
Hello.
Good evening.
Hello.
How are you all doing?
Good.
All right. So in the executive summary is just a brief overview of the Grow Your Own program, and as you can see, it was a program that launched informally around 2015-2016. We formalized the program a bit further in 2019, and that was just really solidifying the contract. But because of teacher shortages and just the conversations that we've had in the district, we know it's really important for us to really formalize our Grow Your Own program, not just to racially diversify our staff to meet the expectations in the strategy map, but also to consider the hard-to-fill areas that we're seeing in the system. So it's going to be wide, but right now, in order for us to be able to launch the program in October with the expectation of a new enrollees starting in their program in January, and the reason for that is to stay consistent with the fiscal year for tax purposes. We really want to get it going in October, but as I looked at the old contract, we really didn't have like limits to the program, and there was just language that was also really loose, so I had our school attorney take a look at it, offered suggestions, I cleaned those up, and then the only thing that I need from you all is approval of the amended contract. And one big thing that was changed is that we now will cap the program at 5 years, so each candidate can receive up to $5,000 per year with a max of $25,000 of support from the district. And each year of financial support, the expectation is that that person, once they get their license, will work for us for 1 year. So if they max out the 5 years and the $25,000, the expectation is that they will work for the system for 5 years. So that's the biggest change to the contract. And right now, I'm really just here to answer any questions you may have about the contract and then get it approved so we can get the ball rolling. Yes.
Does it have to be 5 consecutive years, or can they like take a year off or something?
That we haven't ironed out. And another piece of the contract is that they will have to submit program requirements.
Yes, I did see that.
Because as I kind of went back and looked at who's currently in the program, we do have some teachers that already have a bachelor's degree. And so their program is really like an expedited licensure program. But then we do have 2 people in the system that are actually paraeducators. So it will be a longer process. And actually there's an issue right now with practicum hours and student teaching for one of our pairs who really has to be clocked in. And so we're trying to figure that out. But the hope and the expectation is that they stay in the program until they complete it so that they can fulfill their requirements with the service. But that's a really good question and probably a conversation for teaching and learning to really hammer that out.
It looked like a good contract, though. It was very descriptive overall.
Other questions?
What are our success stories with Grow Your Own?
We have had 4 candidates successfully complete the program. We have 4 that are currently enrolled in the program. And we tried a pilot when DPI opened up the door for the ABCTE program, which was an online expedited process. And we had some of our student and family engagement specialists actually enter that program. one successfully completed, the others were struggling, and we've seen this with other candidates where some of the standardized testing or your testing for basic skills, some of our employees have struggled to pass that test, but I know in the past, Sherry has really been working with DPI to look at alternative pathways to certification and not just those standardized tests like the FORT test, mm-hmm. which is the fundamentals of reading examination. And I know we had a candidate, a person of color that was actually in the system for about 12 years and took the FORT test like 9 times and couldn't pass it. So there are some things, right, you know, at the DPI level that we really have to continue to have conversations to look at alternative pathways. But we're no longer using the ABCTE program. And so with this newly revamped program, we are aware of different programs in the area that our staff can participate in. But then it's just really a matter of getting the program requirements and really helping them work through that. So in this, you don't see it in the contract, but we are going to have to build a mentoring system for our candidates to make sure that they are being supported throughout the process, even when it comes down to the student teaching. Mm-hmm. So that's something that you don't see right here in the contract, but something that we will definitely build and make sure that our candidates can find success in the mm-hmm. program.
I think mentoring is fantastic. If we have 4 candidates now, in a perfect world, how many would you like to add this fall?
So it's going to be really interesting, right? We've been able to carry over money from the past 2 years, and we just received a $15,000 donation from the Ed Foundation.
Awesome.
So I think we're looking at roughly $80,000 in the account right now. But it's really going to be dependent on when people finish and then what the program requirements will be. So it's going to be like a funky staggering process, but my hope is that we may be able to add 4 or 5 more this year. But once I figure out the 4 that are in the program, how long it will take for them to finish will give me an idea of how many that we can start this year.
Is there some concurrent employment? Like, so let's say we have a para in the program and then it comes to student teaching, and can they do some of those things concurrently with being employed and being in the program, or does their income stop in order to do?
So it's, I don't know what DPI says. We've had those conversations. But even myself, right, when I was working in the Madison School District, I just had a bachelor's degree, and so I went and pursued my teaching license. But then when it was time for me to student teach, Bruce Diamond was like, I can't, you still have to get your salary. So he was able to work it out where I was able to stay in my role while student teaching. I think it's really going to be a matter of the flexibility of the administration and then whatever we decide at district level in terms of, you know, how much support we can provide an employee when it comes down to student teaching and being able to stay in their role at the same time.
That Bruce Dahlman, quite a guy.
I'm biased at all.
We have precedence.
Yeah. I think, you know, most programs are pretty flexible.
Yeah.
And I think you know, Percy has great relationships with our training institutions. A lot of people do. And so we'll be able to get creative with those things.
Because I'm thinking when teachers are pursuing administrative licenses, oftentimes they are teaching and then they are on a prep period or something doing some sort of observation of administrative roles. I mean, it works in that regard, because I wouldn't think that oftentimes people can give up a salary to finish that last piece of student teaching.
And the administrative piece is a lot easier, right? Because they can attend board meetings after the school day or leadership meetings.
Or this is in a classroom. Yeah.
Right.
Thank you for all of this. It's a great opportunity for us to hold on to our people and also fill the roles that are needed.
You know, it's really been a lot of people going back to the school board and the membership in 2015 and 16 that really supported it. You know, Tabitha, Laura Love, who are no longer here, you know, they were involved. It's really been a collective effort. But now I think, you know, because of everything that's going on and, you know, really looking out at our fine-tuned strategy map. Grow Your Own is just an important piece mm-hmm. that we really need to solidify into the system that will help us, not just with our strategy map goals, but even looking at, you know, the possible actually ongoing teacher shortages that we're seeing.
Yeah, again, I'll echo previous comments. Thank you for what you're doing. It certainly sounds as we're doing this, there, we have struggles, internal struggles for some of our candidates getting to the point of, just like you said, the teaching hours and such that. Can you just kind of give me an idea, because you've actually mentioned two or three different types. We have paraeducators, some people who have some or little education. We have people like, as you gave an example yourself, who had a bachelor's but yet didn't have the teaching license. Can you just give me an idea of the candidates that you're looking at right now? You said four possibly coming in.
There's four currently enrolled,
right.
And then we have kind of people that we've hired under emergency license for special ed, and if they wanted to go ahead and move in that direction, we will probably support them too. But it will be open to the entire district, so we're not going to exclude paraeducators. And so it's really going to be a matter of the selection team and looking at all of the candidates, their applications, their references. They have to write a personal statement. And then from there, you know, I'll be having a meeting with Dr. Romero Johnson to really flush out next steps in terms of who will be the selection committee. And so then by November, we should know who those new candidates will be. So it won't just be limited to those with bachelor degrees that can take the expedited process, but we do want to open it up to paraeducators, even though that will be a longer mm-hmm. process. Like, we have some campus support staff mm-hmm. At the high school that are really interested in Grow Your Own, but they only have, you know, maybe a semester or a year of college credits. And so their pathway is going to be longer or not much different than what it will look like for students once we get that built. So it will be staggered, right? And I think it'll be a matter of how many do we want to let in with a bachelor's degree that can get the licensure a lot faster, but then what will that look like for those that will have a longer process?
Thank you. That makes it a little clearer to me.
You mentioned students, because I know we've talked about Grow Your Own with student programming and eventually keeping some of our stars to work for our district. Is that related to this, or is that farther down the road?
This is separate. I know there is some work where there's a partnership with Madison College in the high school, where Madison College is now building a pre-education program. And so once that gets off the ground.
We have kids in it now.
Oh, we do?
Yep, we do.
Awesome. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But the awesome thing about Madison College is the Madison College promise, right? If we can get our students into that program, they can receive up to six semesters of tuition being fully covered.
What?
And I just read that UW-Madison School of Ed will also be launching a Grow Your Own program where they will cover tuition as long as graduates go and work in a Wisconsin school. So if we can tie those two together, mm-hmm. I mean, it might not cost us a dime, right, to get our students to be able to build and go through that pathway. So those are things that are in the works. I know there are several people in the system that are keeping their eyes open or already in partnership with Madison College. So I can totally see that probably in the next year or so being built, and hopefully it will be zero cost to the district for our students to hit that pipeline.
Great. Well, thank you so much. No further questions. This will be an action item mm-hmm. on September 27th in our meeting there. Love to give you a vote tonight, but you'll see that vote on the 27th.
No, I can wait until the 27th. It gives myself and Dr. Romero Johnson a little bit of time to flesh out some of these things. And I do appreciate that question about concurrent. Because I think we need to have that fleshed out before we send the application out, and that was a blind spot, so I appreciate that very much. And I tried to get that board member right there to do Grow Your Own, but he decided to become my boss.
He was one step ahead of you the whole time.
Yeah, there you go.
Simmering. Up to you. Up to you.
Hey. All right.
Thank you,
perfect.
Percy.
Perfect. Thank
all
you.
Right.
Thank you.
Well,
thank you.
Thank you.
We have only one item for action tonight, which is approval of the athletic code update.
So last meeting, Jamie Sims and Brad Crandall were here to present the updated athletic code, and we're here tonight asking for your approval.
Move to approve.
Second.
Well, we had a race for motion to approve and an even faster race for the second. Motion in good order. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. And I know it's hard to believe, but we're at item 8 already, which is discussing next meeting dates and adjournment. Our future meeting date, September 19th, 7 p.m. right here, the annual business meeting. And then September 27th at 7 p.m., regular meeting at Elm Lawn Elementary School on the 27th. Reach out to me if you have any potential agenda items for our next meeting. And there's only one last motion I'm looking for, and that's a motion to adjourn.
A quick question.
Quick question.
At Elm Lawn, is that the listening session?
No.
Okay. That wasn't. Okay. Just making sure.
Good question.
First listening session is in October.
October. Okay.
Yeah. October 24th.
Just a reminder, the 27th is Tuesday. I know that's totally out of whack with Monday night meetings, but just a reminder that it's a Tuesday.
On the October 24th, you said that board meeting is canceled, but the listening session is still.
10th.
Yep. So the 24th, you'll have a listening session at 6, board meeting at 7.
Board meeting is on the 24th, canceled on the 10th.
Correct.
Yes. Only a little complicated.
Well, it's nice to see a board that's in no rush to adjourn. But anyone want to make a motion?
I will make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second. Motion in good order. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you and good night.
What? This feels weird.
35 minutes.
So Peg Shoemaker is listening online because we're streaming live now.
Oh, good.
And we'll organize.